Welcome to CodeOps HQ, your channel for all things programming, Linux, and DevOps. Today, we're starting with a beginner-friendly guide to setting up the perfect developer environment on Linux. Whether you're a programmer, a DevOps enthusiast, or diving into tech, this video will set you up for a professional workflow. Let's jump in. First things first, let's choose a Linux distribution. For developers, Fedora is a fantastic choice thanks to its cutting-edge features, reliability, and solid community support. If you're leaning more towards DevOps, Ubuntu or PopOS are excellent alternatives. Today, we'll go with Fedora because it's a powerful, secure, and versatile option for all our development and DevOps needs. You can download the Fedora ISO from the official site, and if you need a step-by-step installation guide, check the links in the description. A productive terminal is the backbone of any developer's workflow. Let's start by enhancing our terminal with Z-Shell and OMYZSH, which provide a more customizable and feature-rich experience. ZSH, or the Z-Shell, is a popular shell for developers, which builds upon the default bash shell to offer more flexibility, better scripting capabilities, and lots of handy features for developers. With ZSH, you'll benefit from enhanced auto-completion, syntax highlighting, powerful scripting support, and plenty of customization options, making it a top choice for an efficient terminal setup. To install ZSH on Fedora, open your terminal and type sudo dnf install zsh. Press enter and let Fedora's package manager handle the installation. If you're using a different Linux distribution, don't worry, every major package manager has ZSH available in its repositories. Here are the commands for other popular distributions. Once ZSH is installed, we can switch to it by making it our default shell. To do this, type the following command. After running this command, log out and log back in to activate ZSH as your default shell. With our shell set to ZSH, let's take it a step further with OMYZSH. To set up OMYZSH, we'll need Git as a requirement to manage themes and plugins. If Git isn't already installed on your system, you can install it by using your package manager. After installing, head to the official GitHub page, copy the installation command, and paste it into your terminal to install OMYZSH. Follow the prompts, and you'll soon see your terminal transformed with themes and plugins. A text editor is an essential tool for any developer. While there are plenty of options out there, today we're focusing on Vim, a highly efficient, customizable, and keyboard-driven editor that's perfect for writing code, managing configurations, and more. To get started with Vim, let's install it. To install Vim, use your package manager. Since we're using Fedora, we'll be using DNF. Once installed, you can open Vim by simply typing Vim in your terminal and pressing enter. Let's now customize Vim to make it more user-friendly and tailored to our workflow. Vim is incredibly powerful out of the box, but adding a few settings to its configuration file can significantly enhance the experience. To start customizing, create or open the .vimrc file in your home directory using Vim. Once in Vim, press I to enter insert mode and add the following settings. Add syntax on to enable syntax highlighting. Add set number to show line numbers. Add set relative number to show relative line numbers. Add set tab stop equals for to set tab width to 4 spaces. Add set shift width equals for tot set indentation width to 4 spaces. Add set expand tab to use spaces instead of tabs. Add set cursor line to highlight the current line. After adding these settings, press the escape key to exit insert mode, then type :wq and press enter to save the file and exit Vim. With these settings, Vim becomes more intuitive and aesthetically pleasing, especially for coding tasks. Feel free to explore other settings and plugins to further customize Vim. To get the most out of Vim, here are some essential shortcuts to help you navigate and edit files efficiently. Up next, we'll dive into version control with Git. Version control is an essential skill for developers, enabling them to manage changes, collaborate on projects, and keep track of their work. Git is the most popular version control system, and we'll be exploring it today. Let's dive into setting it up and learning some core commands to get started. First, we need to install Git. The process slightly differs depending on your Linux distribution. Let's install it by using our package manager. Once installed, verify it by checking Git version. Before using Git, we need to configure it with your name and email address. This information will be attached to your commits so you can keep track of your contributions. Then verify your configuration. Use git config --list. To start using Git in a project, navigate to your project directory and initialize a new Git repository with Git in it. This command creates a hidden .git folder in your project directory, marking it as a Git repository. To track files in your repository, use the git add command. For example, to add a specific file, type git add file name. Or, to stage all files in your project, type git add dot or use --A. Once your changes are staged, save them with a commit message using git commit -m, then your commit message. Commit messages should briefly describe what changes you've made. To view the current state of your repository, use git status. This command shows which files are staged, modified, or untracked. To see the history of your commits, type git log. Git becomes even more powerful when paired with remote repositories like GitHub or GitLab. To interact with GitHub or GitLab securely, let's set up an SSH key. This ensures a secure connection and eliminates the need to enter your password repeatedly. Run the SSH key gen command in your terminal, replace the email with yours. If you're prompted for a file location, press Enter to use the default. When asked for a passphrase, you can leave it empty or add one for extra security. Copy your SSH key to your clipboard. Then go to GitHub and go to Settings, SSH and GPG keys and click New SSH key. Paste the key, give it a title, and save it. For GitLab, go to Preferences, SSH keys and click Add New Key. Paste the key, give it a title, and save it. Then verify the connection. To link your local repository to a remote one, create a repository on GitHub or GitLab and copy the repository SSH URL. Then type git remote add origin and paste or write your repository URL and hit enter. Replace the URL with the link to your repository. After linking, you can push your changes to the remote repository with git push. With Git set up and an SSH key configured, you're ready to securely manage your code and collaborate with teams. In the next section, we'll explore how to set up and use Docker for containerized development environments. Docker has revolutionized software development by making it easier to create, deploy, and run applications in isolated environments. In this section, we'll explore how to set up Docker, understand its core concepts, and learn the basics to get started with containerized development. To begin using Docker, we need to install it. First, we need to add Docker repo to our package manager, then install it. For more information, check out Docker Docs. Once installed, start the Docker service. Then, if you want, you can enable it to run at startup. Finally, verify the installation by checking the Docker version. Let's ensure Docker is working correctly by running the Hello World test container. This command pulls a test image from Docker Hub and runs it in a container. If you see the output, Docker is set up correctly. That means our Docker setup is correct. By default, Docker requires root privileges. To simplify its usage, let's add our user to the Docker group. Log out and back in, or refresh your session. Test the configuration. Now, let's briefly touch on Docker's core functionality. Think of Docker as a tool to run lightweight virtual environments called containers. Pull an image from Docker Hub using Docker Pull. Run a container from an image by using Docker Run. This starts an Nginx server on port 8080. Stop a running container by Docker stop then container ID. We can view container ID by using Docker PS. Remove a container by Docker RM container ID. That's a quick introduction to Docker. We've set up Docker, tested it, and explored its basic functionality. In a future video, we'll dive deeper into Docker's capabilities, including creating custom images, using Docker Compose, and optimizing workflows. Next up is Tmux, a terminal multiplexer that allows us to manage multiple terminal sessions within a single window. We can install it with our package manager. Tmux is incredibly useful for multitasking and keeping the workflow organized. We'll dive deeper into Tmux tips and tricks in future videos, so stay tuned if you're interested. For a final productivity boost, let's create a simple automation script to keep our system updated. This script will update packages and clean up unnecessary files, saving time and keeping things organized. Save this as update.sh, make it executable and run it to keep the system optimized. To recap, we covered setting up Fedora Linux with customizations for ZSH, configuring Vim as our primary editor, and installing essential tools like Git, Docker, and Tmux. We even set up a basic automation script to streamline system update. Thanks for watching. If this guide helped you, subscribe for more tech tutorials from CodeOps HQ. Let us know in the comments which tools you want to see next. See you in the next video.